everyone, Anna here with the Coding Guild. Today we are going to have a look at MS-DRGs in more detail and we'll examine how the system is built, what information factors into the final MS-DRG assignment, and how it all comes together with present on-admission indicators, hospital-acquired conditions, and the CC exclusion list. What are MS-DRGs and why do we have this system? In the most simplistic terms, MS-DRGs are kind of a sorting mechanism that will help CMS quickly decide what payment bracket a patient should fall into for their inpatient stay. As we know, patients in acute care facilities can command extremely high prices for complex traumas, or they can cost close to nothing if they present for a simple fracture, for example. In the prophy and outpatient world, it is easy to calculate the cost because we are using procedure codes on a fee-for-service basis or with bundled payments. But unfortunately for inpatient stays, it is not going to work like that. So instead of paying these facilities on a fee-for-service basis, CMS created these all-inclusive package deals that we call MS-DRGs. The MS-DRG will be connected to either the patient's principal diagnosis or the principal procedure that is performed. We are going to look at these in more detail in a moment. So using procedures to substantiate payment makes a lot of sense and it's very logical, but why would CMS opt for using the principal diagnosis in most cases? Well, the logic behind this is that modern medicine is using treatment protocols. When a patient shows up to the hospital, the doctors already know what is going to happen to that patient. They know what type of drugs are going to be needed, how intense the nursing care is going to be, how long the patient is expected to stay, etc. They don't know the exact details for that one patient, of course, but in general they have an idea as to what they expect to happen next. CMS capitalizes on this by putting price tags on these known protocols. CMS can calculate how much any given inpatient stay shall cost if the hospital adheres to established medical guidelines as they are expected to do. Don't forget that CMS has access to actual cost data because facilities are expected to send CMS cost reports. Under the MS-DRG system, CMS assumes that all patients who show up with the same diagnosis will consume roughly the same amount of resources and will cost more or less the same amount of money to be treated. Because of this, patients presenting with the same principal diagnosis or same principal procedure will always end up in the same MS-DRG if it's a simple case. All MS-DRGs have a relative value assigned to them, what shows how intense and expensive that given diagnosis is to treat compared to all other diagnoses and MS-DRGs. So why is it good for CMS to have this MS-DRG system? Well, in short, it saves them time and money. They don't have to bother with itemized bills for inpatient admissions, and they also know in advance how much they will be expected to pay for any given inpatient admission. Again, it is based on medical protocols. They expect the hospital to treat the patient presenting with the same problem according to the established protocols, and they already know what that entails, what kind of procedure, what kind of resources, etc. It's easy to price. The general idea with this system here is that for average cases, CMS will not adjust the payment. They assume how much this patient will cost based on the protocol, they price the package according to their expectation, and then they pay that price. For normal cases, this package deal price is all the facility gets. This is how CMS saves money with this system. This can be either good or bad for the facility, because if they are efficient and can treat the patient for less than what they get from CMS, then they can keep that amount and make a profit. On the other hand, if they are wasteful and not effective enough, they will lose on that patient. Of course, we have to add that this is the general idea, and there are always cases where CMS acknowledges the need for additional payment. Now let's see how we actually find MS-DRGs. Honestly speaking, we coders don't find the MS-DRG. We don't do it by hand. In real life, the DRG grouper is going to do it for us, represented here by this tree. The patient enters with their procedure or diagnosis code over here, and then the grouper processes their case using a lot of yes or no questions to decide what path to take and what DRG to get closer to or rule out. Questions on the way will involve the patient's primary diagnosis, the principal diagnosis, secondary diagnoses, any procedures, comorbidities, complications, was there any hospital-acquired condition, what the discharge status is, etc. As you can see, this process can become very complex, real fast, especially for serious inpatient cases. So it makes a lot of sense to let the software do it and not us, because don't forget, hospital's reimbursement actually depends on correct MS-DRG assignment. But because we all like a good challenge, let's look behind the curtain and figure out what the MS-DRG grouper actually does. The first step in the process of MS-DRG assignment is determining whether the case qualifies for a pre-MDC or not. Normally, inpatient cases are grouped by the principal diagnosis, but there are some very costly and complex encounters that need to be assigned to payment groups based on the procedures performed. These are also cases where the diagnosis assigned might not be a good indicator of the severity of the illness or the necessary resource use. For example, tracheostomy procedures could be performed for injuries, cancer, respiratory diseases, etc. A principal diagnosis of neoplasm of larynx might not correctly reflect how intense this one case turns out to be, and because of this, the case will end up in its own special group, a pre-MDC, instead of getting assigned to MDC-03 for the throat malignancy. MDC-03 would not reimburse the hospital for the costs associated with tracheostomy and all related care. In the latest grouper version for 2021, in version V38.0, we have 11 pre-MDCs. You can see the list here: chimeric antigen receptor, heart transplant, ECMO, liver intestinal transplant, bone marrow transplant, etc. If we click on any of these categories, we can see, let's try this one, we can see the list of procedure codes that can qualify a case for pre-MDC assignment. If the patient we are coding for had any of these procedures performed from this list, they will be immediately assigned to this DRG-007. If a patient qualifies for any of these procedures or anything else from the list here, any other one of these within these pre-MDC DRGs, then the DRG assignment process stops and ends right here. We found our case, this is where we end. Again, this is only for these given procedures listed here. Please take the time to click on all of these groups and review the procedures associated with them to have a better understanding as to what you are looking for when you are coding for inpatient cases. Now, if the case does not qualify for a pre-MDC because the patient didn't have any of these procedures performed, then we have to proceed with the usual process and find the correct DRG based on principal diagnosis, secondary diagnoses, and lesser procedures if performed. Now, the first step here in assigning DRGs using the principal diagnosis is to correctly identify the principal diagnosis itself. It is very important because different principal diagnoses will provide us with different DRG decision trees. And once this decision tree has been chosen, we are kind of confined to a given number of outcomes. If we chose this principal diagnosis, these are the questions we are going to be presented with. This is the decision tree. For the other diagnosis, this is the decision tree we are going to go down. And there is absolutely no communication between these trees. So if we realize that we picked the wrong principal diagnosis, we started from the wrong point, we have to go back to the very beginning, reassign the principal diagnosis, and do it again. So if we have our principal diagnosis down, now it will have to be decided what major diagnostic category it belongs to. Major diagnostic categories are big groupings, if you will, holding DRGs together that are somehow similar to each other. This similarity is based on usually organ system, medical specialty, or etiology of the disease process. Major diagnostic categories can be divided into two groups, organ system based ones and miscellaneous. This is not an official method of looking at them, but I find it easier to divide them like so. If we go back to the manual for a moment, we can observe all these MDCs. So as you can see, from 1 to down here to 19, we have all the organ systems, body areas, and etiologies we are already familiar with from ICD-10-CM, right? Nervous, eye, ENT, etc. And after that, we have what I called miscellaneous for dependencies, injuries, burns, multiple trauma, HIV, and the Z codes. But how do we know which major diagnostic category our principal diagnosis will belong to? Well, we look it up in Appendix B. Appendix B is down here, diagnosis code MDC MS-DRG index. For example, let's look up atrioventricular block first degree, code I440. As we can see, it will map to MDC05 and will fall into one of these DRGs depending on other factors. Let's look up MDC05. MDC05 stands for Diseases and Disorders of the Circulatory System. By clicking on it, we can see all the details pertaining to this MDC. On the top here, we have a listing of all diagnosis codes belonging to this MDC. Just to check, let's find our code I440, atrioventricular block first degree, so we know that we are at the right place with this MDC. Be careful, sometimes it has several pages, as you can see it up here, page 105. And now the next step will be to decide whether we need to proceed to a surgical or a medical part of the MDC. So we know that this was not a pre-MDC, we found our principal diagnosis, we looked it up in Appendix B, we know that we have to go to MDC05, and now within the MDC, there will be a differentiation between surgical cases and medical cases. As we mentioned, MDCs are comprehensive groups housing medically similar diagnoses or conditions belonging to the same organ system. And because there is such a variety of treatments possible, MDCs will be further specified into these two groupings, surgical or medical. If a patient has a qualifying procedure performed during the inpatient stay, their case will go on to one of the surgical DRGs. But if there was no qualifying procedure, the case is a medical DRG. So let's continue with our example in here. We are back to the main page of MDC05. MDC5 has a long list of surgical DRGs and connected procedure codes. You can see the header here, surgical DRGs, operating room procedure of, and then we have to find what happened to our patient. By clicking on any of these headers, a list of procedure codes come up that can qualify the patient for falling into one of these DRGs. If the patient had any of these operating room procedures and nothing else, they will fall into DRG 215. There is a variety in these listings though, so be careful when you are assigning DRGs. For example, if we come here, we see a simple list of procedures. If any of these is performed for the patient, they probably qualify for DRG 215. But if we go to the defibrillator category, we are presented with a very different look. First of all, we have combination procedure codes, so more than one will have to be performed, a whole cluster. Then we also have this table up here that immediately clarifies the DRG further, asking us whether there was myocardial infarct present, heart failure, or shock. We also have to know whether cardiac cath was performed for this patient and whether there was an MCC, a major complication or comorbidity, or not. When you see something like this with more details, don't panic because all the codes are given to you. While deciding whether the patient qualifies for any of these conditions, you can find the diagnosis codes by scrolling to the very bottom. It starts here. And then we go on to page 2. Do you see page 1 of 2? This is how you know it. We go on to the second half of the diagnosis. So this is what the table is asking you about when it asks whether there was infarct, shock, or failure. As for the other question about cardiac cath, these procedure codes are also here for you. To reach the cardiac cath codes, so if any of these was performed for your patient, then you can answer yes to that question in the table above. Notice how it says non-operating room procedures. This is a good reminder for us that not every procedure will have to take place in the operating room in order to factor into the DRG. If the case we are coding for has any of these procedures coded, it will count as a surgical MDC. And the next step for the grouper would be here to determine the appropriate surgical hierarchy if more than one procedure was performed, or it can maybe assign the case to an unrelated procedure DRG. That just means that the patient's principal diagnosis and the performed procedure have nothing to do with each other. There is a separate DRG for that. We are not going to go into detail on how to pick the appropriate procedure from the surgical hierarchy because I'm trying to keep this video under an hour, but please know that there are separate appendices where you can find this information. Appendix D, E, and F will help you with the surgical hierarchy and with all the procedure codes. Now let's get back to our case and assume that there was no procedure performed. As I mentioned already, if there is no procedure, then this will be a medical case, right? Because that was our choice. We either go to surgical based on procedure or we go down to medical if there was no procedure. We are back to MDC-5. We decided, let's say, that we do not have a surgical case. So we have to scroll down, down, down until we find medical DRGs based on the principal diagnosis of, and now we have to find our code I-440. I-440 was a cardiac arrhythmia. It will be right here, principal diagnosis. So we know again that we are at the right place. Because we know that there was no procedure performed and we fall into MDC-5 under cardiac arrhythmia, we know that our final DRG assignment will have to fall into one of these DRGs based on the presence or absence of complications and comorbidities. Complications and comorbidities, or major CCs, are secondary conditions that can affect the inpatient stay. These are either pre-existing conditions or situations that arise during the inpatient admission. You can find the complete list of CCs and MCCs in Appendix G and H. As you can see, diagnosis defined as complications or comorbidities or major complications or comorbidities. And if you have any secondary diagnoses listed on your case that will be found in these lists, you might be able to upgrade your patient to a higher paying DRG. And I'm saying you might be able because there are two very important caveats that we have to mention here. Excluded conditions and comorbidities and hospital acquired conditions will not act as CC or MCC. You can find hospital acquired conditions down here in Appendix I, while the exclusion list is Appendix C. I already posted full-length videos with demonstrations on both of these topics and how to use these appendices. Please find the videos up there and also in the description below. We are at this step right now. We already decided what our principal diagnosis was, which major diagnostic category it fell into. We already decided whether it was surgical or medical. And now we were looking at whether we had complications, comorbidities, major complications, comorbidities, or none of those. Let's assume that our case has none of those. We go back to MDC-5. We already decided that we did not have a surgical case. I go back to the medical part of this MDC. This was a cardiac arrhythmia. Our principal diagnosis is still here. And we said that there was no MCC, no CC, so we choose the bottom line here. And our final DRG assignment will be 310. DRG 310 stands for cardiac arrhythmia and conduction disorders without CC, MCC. Alright, so we are at this step. We have arrived to our MS-DRG. It was 310. Now let's recap and have a look at what we actually did here. First of all, we looked at the case and considered whether there was any procedure that would qualify the case as a pre-MDC without looking at any principal diagnosis at all. If you remember, it had 11 categories with very serious procedures, mainly transplants. Please review that list, because if there is anything there that the patient had done to them, then that's where the MS-DRG process stops. On the other hand, if the patient does not qualify for this, we went on to find the principal diagnosis to make sure that this is 100% correct, because that's the starting point that kind of limits all our choices going forward. From the principal diagnosis, we used Appendix B to decide which major diagnostic category the principal diagnosis will fall into. Then within the major diagnostic category, we further specified whether we had a medical or a surgical case. We decided this based on the procedures listed under the surgical categories. This was on top of the MDC. We did not look at this part of the assignment process, but the grouper would also establish the surgical hierarchy if there was more than one procedure performed. And it would also decide whether the procedure was related or unrelated to the principal diagnosis, because then it goes to a different separate DRG. Whatever the case be, whether it's a medical or a surgical case, we further had to specify whether we had complications, comorbidities, major complications or comorbidities, or none of those. As I said, there are also these important caveats when we decide whether there is a CC or MCC, namely the exclusion list and the hospital-acquired conditions. Please don't forget to check out those videos, because that's a separate process in deciding whether or not you have these. And after this, we were able to filter down our MS-DRG to the final 310. Of course, this process was a little bit simplified for us now, because the grouper would also take into consideration the patient's discharge disposition, neonatal age, if there was any special procedure performed for the pre-MDC, and the patient's sex. That's all we had for today. I hope it was helpful. Thank you for being here with me. Don't forget to check out the resources in the description below. There will be the manual for you, the present on admission and hospital acquired condition video, the CC exclusion list video. These two come with a free quiz, by the way. I also put there a general medical coding study guide with all my best tips, hints, and ideas on how to succeed in your medical coding and auditing career. And there will be a contact info as well. If you have any questions or video requests, please let me know. Thank you again. I will see you soon in our next video.